Cool. So thanks everyone for the warm welcome. Really excited to be here in Malaysia, as well as Malaysia obviously being the food paradise of the world, the food capital of the world. I have a pretty close connection with Malaysia in that my mum was actually born here, and my brothers actually live here, and they're up in the crowd at the moment. So I love coming back to Malaysia, but one of the things that I haven't been able to do is to soak up the vibe of the local startup ecosystem here. So it's incredible to see, you know, all of you guys here in this room, and you know, to have you guys embrace everything that MaGIC provides is truly awesome. I only wish that we had the accelerators and the programs that you guys have access to. So let's give a round of applause to Cheryl and the MaGIC team. What they've accomplished in just a year is incredibly amazing. So what I wanted to do first of all is just take you on a little bit of a story about a serial entrepreneur. And his name was Choi Soo Hoi, and he was my great-great-grandfather. And so Choi Soo Hoi was born in 1838 in China, and he did all of the usual things that someone would do. He found a wife, he started a young family, but then with the pressure of that young family, he decided that he was going to go out and explore the world and to try and find his fortune with other gold miners on the gold fields of California. And then also, following the gold, he moved to Australia and then finally to the new frontier of the gold rush, which was New Zealand. But by the time Choi Soo Hoi got to New Zealand, he'd worked out that gold mining was actually a pretty terrible idea, in that you have to have all sorts of heavy tools, picks and shovels, and you're smashing rocks, and then you're dragging those rocks down to the river and, trying to sift through all the rocks just to find maybe, a few flakes of gold. And, that was on a good day. And so instead, Choi Soo Hoi thought, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to sell the picks and sell the shovels and sell the pans to the other gold miners. And so he set up a merchant business where basically, he was selling those tools and supplies to the local community, and he ended up, basically creating that as his first startup. And so he built up a really big business, and also included an import and export arm with countries as far away as his homeland in China. And then the gold started to run out, just as it had in California and Australia. And so Choi Soo Hoi, kind of felt the pressure of that because obviously there was less money going around in the local community. And so one day, Choi Soo Hoi was looking out into the harbour and he saw the harbour dredge with, giant conveyor belts and buckets scooping out the sand at the bottom of the harbour to try and make deeper channels for all the ships to pass through. And that's when he had a light bulb moment. And he pioneered the world's first gold dredge, which basically sat in the middle of the river and used the same bucket system to scoop out the rocks, but also the gold that no one else could get to in the middle of the river. And upon testing out one prototype, which proved successful, he then quickly formed a company and built three more dredges. And, word began to spread. And then all of a sudden, competitors were popping up left, right, and center all over the world, all inspired by the original Soo Hoi dredge design. And so, he's obviously a pretty clever guy. And when I think about Choi Soo Hoi and, what made him successful, for me it comes down to three things. He had the curiosity to innovate and to try new things. He obviously had, plenty of hustle to, push through and, build a giant machine that could mine gold when no one had done it before. And then, he obviously had a strong reason why. He had a family back home in China, and then, also the local community and, their struggle of trying to make money. And so, if you think about, those past times with today, so much has changed. And yet, if you think about an entrepreneur and what it takes to become an entrepreneur, I think, we find that those three reasons are still the same, those traits. But, of course, we don't talk about gold mining anymore. The gold rush today is the internet. So let's talk about the internet. So
The business that I've been fortunate enough to be part of with over the last 7 years is called 99 Designs. And we were founded in Melbourne in 2008 and have now expanded. And you know what I'm going to do is share with you nine tips or the nine lessons that I've learned in how to take a startup global. How many people have heard of 99 Designs? Awesome, quite a few people. So for those of you that don't know, in a nutshell, what we do is we connect the world with great graphic designers. So I guess we're most famous for pioneering the idea of a design contest, where you actually get multiple designers competing to deliver you the best design. So how it works is you'd come to 99 Designs, and let's say you're after a logo. You would fill out a design brief. Specify how much you want to pay. It starts at $299 for a logo. And then over the course of 7 to 10 days, you typically get 80 to 100 different logos from maybe a dozen different designers, and then you choose your favorite. And if you, you know, we also have a 100% money back guarantee. So, you know, if you don't happen to find anything you like, which is really the case, then, you know, we'll give your money back to you. But the easiest way to kind of get your head around what we do is to look at a few examples. So this is the logo for Docker. And Docker is a company that's, you know, been pretty popular over the last couple of years and risen to fame and fortune because they've made the process of software development a lot easier for developers. So, you know, if you're an engineer, I'm sure you'll know about these guys. They're now valued at over $1 billion. And, you know, I won't say that, you know, they're valued at $1 billion because of our logo, but, you know, it's a pretty great logo. Next case study is a local company, actually, by the name of Cinnamon Cacao. And so these guys are actually formed by the same team that's behind a pretty great coffee shop in KL. It was called Artisan Roast, and it's, you know, been awarded, I think, best coffee shop in KL for a couple of years in a row now by the Time Out magazine. And so these guys, you know, care a lot about their coffee. They go, you know, they go on trips out to South America to source, you know, coffee beans directly from supplier. And they want to control everything in the process so that they can deliver the best possible tasting coffee to their customers. And so what they wanted to do was take that same craft and love for everything they do and apply it to their second love, which is chocolate. So this company hasn't actually launched yet. They're still trialing out their actual production. But you can see, you know, they got a great logo. And, you know, for just $299, you know, they got 131 designs to choose from. And then the third example I want to just quickly share with you is a pretty recent contest that we run for a company by the name of Britain.co. And Britain.co is a community of creative women and girls all over the world. And they had the idea to come up with the first ever crowdsourced colouring book for grown-ups. The only challenge was that they were on a super, super tight time frame. They needed 24 designs, 24 patterns for their colouring book within the space of 3 days. And so we threw that out to our community and told them that there were going to be over 20 winners, and they just responded in massive fashion. So we received over 1,000 designs for this contest because obviously, you know, it's a very creative brief. You know, they love the idea of being featured in, you know, a colouring book which could potentially go out to hundreds of thousands of people. And sure enough, we awarded 24 winners. So just an example of the scale that's possible when you have a design community like 99 Designs, and something that you know, just wouldn't be able to be achieved in the traditional world of design. So how did we get started? Well, it actually, 99 Designs actually wasn't an idea that we came up with. It started out as a battle of designer egos, let's say. So if you cast your mind back to 2005, there was a company called SitePoint.com that had a pretty popular forum on their website. And on one particular thread in this forum, there was a group of designers who started competing with each other for nothing other than bragging rights. So what would happen is one designer would come up with a brief for a contest. And they'd throw it into this forum thread. And then the other designers would try their best to produce the best design for that brief. And then one of them would be declared the winner. And along one day came somebody who actually needed a logo. And they said, hey, you guys are doing this for fun. How about I put up $100 and whoever designs the best logo takes away the money? And so the designers loved this idea. You know, they were doing something for fun, and then now they were getting paid to do it. And so this little forum thread became known all over the place as a great way to access creativity that, you know, wasn't possible before. And customers began to flock to this forum thread. And the first thing that we tried to do, in line, you know, with Cheryl's description of minimum viable product, was just to lock down that forum thread. It was the simplest possible thing we could do to try and assess, you know, is this actually a viable opportunity? So we locked it down and we charged $10 to post a project into the forum thread. And the first thing that happened was that actually, if anything, that validated the idea that we were providing a design service. And so people came in even stronger numbers. And so we raised the price to $20, and people still came in even greater numbers. And so that was when we realized, okay, you know, we've got a real business opportunity on our hands now. And we launched 99designs.com as a separate brand, a separate entity, and on Valentine's Day 2008. So today, we're the number one marketplace for graphic design in the world. And we've got over 1 million designers from 192 countries. And to just give you an idea of the volume on the marketplace, we see a design uploaded about every 4 seconds. And we've paid out over $115 million to our community of designers. And at any one time, this is a stat I really like, actually. At any one time, we've got over just up to 2,800 open design contest. So, you know, from the perspective of a designer, you know, it doesn't matter whether you're a logo designer, a brochure designer, or you just like to illustrate cats all the time. No matter, you know, what your passion is as a designer, you can find plenty of projects on 99designs. And those projects are for real people, and, you know, they're real opportunities. So, on to my 9 top tips. So the first few tips that I'd like to share with you are all about getting early traction. So, you know, up to this point, we've talked about, you know, getting, I guess, product market fit, and we'd, you know, built 99designs from its humble beginnings as a forum thread. The next thing that we did was to specifically focus on one target market. And for us, we decided to focus on the US market. And there are a few reasons why we chose the US. You know, it's obviously not going to be right for every startup. But for us, you know, we decided, you know, we're native English speakers in Australia. So, you know, that's an easy market to translate to, or doesn't even require translation. Secondly, you know, it's the most e-commerce friendly country in the world. Thirdly, the existing customer base of SitePoint, our parent company, you know, already had a strong US customer base as well. So we could leverage that. And then fourthly, we had a co-founder in Canada, so he was nearby to provide support. But for us, the ability to focus on market just meant that we could strip away a bunch of decisions that we didn't have to think about too early on. So we priced everything in US dollars. You know, we spelled everything with Z's instead of S's. And that meant that, you know, we could really clarify what we were building and who we were building for. And that started to work over time. Word of mouth pretty quickly started to gather, and particularly in places like San Francisco, where there was a strong support from the local tech entrepreneur community. And those guys were our early adopters. Second tip I'd like to share is, you know, just always, always talk to your customers. Now, you know, we all know, you know, those of us in the tech community, we generally are pretty shy, and, you know, and antisocial at the best of times. It's really, really important that you get outside your office and, you know, go out and talk to your customers. You know, for us, we thought we had built the dream business. You know, we thought that, you know, you could put up a website and basically let the servers do all of the work. That, you know, you all you had to do was wake up the next morning and, you know, count the cash from all of the US customers that had come in the night before. But then problems started to crop up. You know, the US customers who thought we were a US company all of a sudden started to complain that, you know, it was taking us too long to respond to support emails because they were used to dealing with, you know, US companies that had, you know, time frames of a couple of hours to get back to them, whereas we had, you know, they had to wait till the next day when it was dealing with, you know, us as an Australian company. And so we realized, okay, if we want to target the US and 65% of our existing customer base is in the US, we're going to have to put people in the market itself. So we established a US office and hired some local support staff, and then we tried out the idea of putting our phone number on the website. And immediately the calls started to come in. And the first few calls were actually pretty eye-opening. You know, we'd pick up the phone and say, hello, this is Jason, welcome to 99 Designs. And then on the other end, the person would say, oh, I guess you guys are a real company. And then they'd hang up. And for us, that was a huge lesson in the importance of building up trust with your customers. That even in, you know, the most e-commerce friendly country in the world, the idea of, you know, swiping a credit card and spending hundreds of dollars to get design online was a brand new thing. And so from that day, we pretty much did a complete backflip. And instead of hiding from our customers, we put our phone number on the site. We put up online chat. We started offering design consultations. And then the money-back guarantee, which we already had, we started making that as prominent as possible to do everything that we could to take away the concern that, you know, we were a credible company. So, next topic I want to talk about is piggybacking on bigger brands. So, you know, by this time we were starting to get, you know, real adoption within the community. Word of mouth was starting to spread, and we wanted to pour some fuel onto that. And so we looked around at, you know, what other companies were doing. And if you think about, you know, I guess how other companies even today are doing it, you know, Airbnb, obviously, you know, they famously got big by piggybacking off Craigslist. And PayPal got big by targeting, you know, eBay's community and being a payment mechanism for eBay. And so for us, we wanted to do this in the design world, but establish ourselves as a design leader as well. And we didn't have to wait too long because the clothing brand Gap actually came along with a pretty terrible logo redesign. You know, on the left here, you've got their classic, you know, logo, timeless logo. And then on the right, one day they just put up this logo on their website without telling anybody. And, you know, I think we can all agree, you know, it's pretty ordinary. And the thing is, the whole world thought it was pretty ordinary. And so, you know, sites all over the world exploded saying that, you know, like, what had they done? And, you know, it's cheap, tacky, and ordinary. And so we thought, okay, this is our perfect opportunity. And what we did was we launched a community contest and put the challenge out to our designers. And we said, hey guys, like, we think we can save Gap here. We put up the prize money ourselves and we got a massive response. You know, we got over 4,500 designers, designs from over 1,000 designers interested. Obviously, you know, it wasn't the prize money that was attractive in this sense. It was the opportunity just to be creative and to work, you know, with a global brand. We said that, you know, we were going to present the design to the management, but by the time we'd run the contest, you know, only a week later, Gap management saw the error of their ways and, you know, went back to their original logo. So, you know, that set the precedent. And since then, we have done community contests for all sorts of logo brands. You know, Hershey's, when they came out with a terrible logo. Yahoo famously had, you know, 30 logos in 30 days. And every time we've done it, we've been able to insert ourselves into the larger conversation that's already happening on the internet. So when we follow up with those reporters and say, hey, you know, like, take a look at the alternatives that we're coming up with, they happily link back to 99designs and also publish new articles about us. So it's a great way to basically attach yourself to a bigger brand and try and piggyback off the attention that they're getting. Fourth story I want to share is, you know, sometimes you just need to hustle harder than the competition. Building on the PR that we started to receive from community contests, we started to look around and look at the US and say, you know, what else? How else can we get ourselves out there and get our brand name out there? And we came upon the Webby Awards. Has anyone heard of the Webby Awards? Yeah, cool. So they're basically like, imagine the Oscars for the internet. That's basically what the Webby Awards are. And we, you know, looked at this and we thought, wow, you know, this is an annual awards. There's a glitzy, you know, dinner party and a ceremony in New York. You know, if we can win this thing, then that would go a long way to establishing our credibility and our awareness in the US. And so we entered into the Webby Awards. We put forward an application and, you know, to our delight, we were shortlisted for the category of best web service or application. But then we looked at the other shortlists and we were horrified because we were also shortlisted with Dropbox and Tumblr. And of course, you know, you guys will know that they're a pretty big deal. You know, they have user bases that are tens, if not hundreds times the size of 99 Designs. And so at first we thought, well, okay, that was a great dream, you know, never going to fly. And then we thought about it and we thought, you know what, maybe we've got a chance here. And so what we did was we came up with a guerrilla email marketing campaign. And it was guerrilla because we obviously didn't want Dropbox and Tumblr to find out about whatever it was that we were doing. If they found out and copied us, then, you know, we would have been dead in the water. So what we did was we came up with a strategy whereby we were going to email our entire community and ask them to vote for us, but only do it at the very last second before the deadline closed so that no one would know what we'd done. And so, obviously, the next keynote, we're going to learn a lot more about email marketing, so, you know, I won't go into the details, but the key part about our strategy was that we needed to give designers and, you know, our customer base a really good reason to vote for us. You know, we couldn't just, you know, put up a prize or ask them to do it out of love. Or, you know, one person suggested we pay them, but we would have been out of business in a second if we'd done that. So what we did was we came up with this idea. And we said to our entire community, if you guys vote for us, and if we win, then we'll get the whole 99 Designs team to go down the main street in Melbourne singing We Are the Champions. And we also said that we would record it and post it on YouTube. And, you know, the community loved it. You know, when they got the emails on the very last day, they came out voting in huge numbers. You know, I guess they were pretty keen to see us embarrass ourselves. And sure enough, when we, you know, checked the site at midnight, we had actually pipped Dropbox and Tumblr at the post. You know, previously they had been way in the lead, you know, with kind of a third of the votes each when we were back at, you know, kind of 13%. And then, you know, with this sneak attack, we were able to actually knock them off at the top of the post and win the Webby Awards. Thanks. And so, I mean, I guess that was part one of the story, because obviously part two of the story was we actually had to do this damn video. And so, as you can imagine, most of the team and, you know, a lot of the engineers were pretty reluctant about starring in this video. But rather than explain what we did, I thought I would just play a minute of you so that you guys can see what we got up to.
Hey, Mark, guess what? Great news. We just won a Webby.
We got a Webby! Yeah!
I've paid my dues. Time after time, I've done my sentence, but committed no crime. And bad mistakes, I've made a few. Trap!
OMG, guys. OMG.
So as you can see, we've got a pretty crazy team at 99 Designs. And I've got to say, you know, that was definitely one of the most fun days that we've ever had at our startup. And things like that, I think things like that where you can inject your personality into the brand go a long way with not only your team, but, you know, your user base. You know, our designers, you know, they obviously, you know, love this. We had over 400 comments on the blog post where we published it, and customers even got behind it as well. So wherever possible, you know, hustle hard, but then also try and get your personality into your brand. Fifth tip I'd like to share is to make friends with nice people. Now, obviously with, you know, the press we've been able to drum up through the community contest and also through the likes of winning the Webby Awards, people started to take notice all of a sudden of, you know, who we were. And we were starting to get, you know, great growth from the user base in America. And it was at that time that all of a sudden, you know, investors started knocking on our door and asking us, you know, whether they could invest in 99 Designs. But to be honest, you know, those conversations didn't go anywhere because we wouldn't know what to do at that stage with money, even if we had raised some money. You know, we'd always been bootstrapped and spent money out of, you know, our own pockets. And so those conversations didn't go very far. But then one company by the name of Excel Partners, based in Silicon Valley, actually took a different approach. And they, instead of talking about money, they just wanted to know how they could open up doors for us. And they introduced us to other companies in the Valley, the founders of Dropbox and Etsy. And so, you know, they were great conversations and kind of like, you know, the traction mentors that Cheryl has, you know, obviously spoken about before. You know, just provided us a way to be, to find out the learnings from companies that, you know, were one step ahead of us. And so from that, we then quickly formed a plan for ideas on how we could go to the next level of growth. And so when we wanted to do that, we started obviously looking for, you know, ways to fund that growth. And we ended up raising a Series A with Excel Partners because they'd proved their value, not only in the money they could provide, but the relationship. Interestingly enough, although we had taken a whole lot of calls from US-based venture companies, we never ever got a single phone call from an Australian venture capital company, which just goes to show that even if, you know, you've got limitations in your local market, you don't need to be held back from it. You know, the world is only getting smaller. So what did we do with, you know, raising a bit of money? Well, what we did was, you know, we used it to pursue other growth strategies like localizing to open up new markets. And so when we looked to tackle this, what we did again is to start with a minimum viable approach. We weren't sure whether this strategy was going to work. And so what we wanted to do was do the smallest thing possible to try and assess, you know, is this actually going to generate growth for 99 Designs? And can we measure that? And so the first thing that we did was we localized for other English-speaking markets in Australia, Canada, and Great Britain. And so the localization for us, or the simplest localization, was local currency, a local domain, so that you know, Google would rank us higher and so that it would appear more trustworthy. And then also local support, and, you know, people on the local design time zone with a local phone number. And all of that took off, you know, like it made those markets grow even faster because we were more trustworthy and, you know, more easily discoverable by those customers. And, you know, you might think it's a bit backwards to be localizing for Australia, but the truth of the matter was we did such a good job of pretending to be a US company that even people in Australia didn't know that, you know, we were from Melbourne. So the next step was to localize for foreign markets. And so this is obviously a whole nother bag of fish. You know, now that you're not talking about, you know, just currency changes, you're talking about translating the entire website into a foreign language. And so the question is, you know, which markets should we do first? And so what we did was we, you know, drew up the list of the countries that could be contenders, and then we also drew up the factors that we'd use to prioritize. And for us, it came down to the GDP, you know, the size of the overall market, the appreciation for design in that market, the internet penetration, given that we're a solely online business, disposable income, just to see how much, you know, money's flying around the market, and also the vibrancy of the local startup scene, you know, given that tech entrepreneurs are typically our early adopters and those that, you know, spread the word quickly to other people. And so all of those factors took us to Germany as being the best candidate for kicking off our internationalization. And so when we took a look around the local marketplace, we found that there were actually already some local design marketplaces, and one in particular called 12 Designer, founded by Eva Missling, that we thought, you know, and we thought their vision matched very closely with 99 Design. So we ended up acquiring 12 Designer, and that gave us the perfect base to expand into the rest of Europe. So we very quickly launched 99designs.de, but then off the back of that, into France, Spain, and Italy as well, as well as the UK. And so our approach to those startups was effectively to treat them as a mini startup. We hired one country manager for each one of those countries, and that country manager's sole job was to own everything for that country. So they looked after the metrics for their customer, for their country, the sales, the customer support, the designer support, getting out and attending local events, but also, you know, site translation as well. And that strategy worked really well because it meant that that person was solely responsible for growing, you know, what was a very early market. And they had everything under their control and, you know, didn't feel like they were held back, you know, by the rest of the 99 Designs team. So today, we're now in 20 countries in 8 different languages, you know, with Spanish in Europe, that, you know, gave us an entry point to go and launch in South America. And then our latest market that we've internationalized for is actually Japan. And Japan, you know, was always high up there on our list. You know, it satisfies all of the criteria of, you know, having a big GDP, having a strong appreciation for design. But Japan's a notoriously difficult market to enter. And so we waited to go there until we had a strong partner. And we found that partner in a company called Recruit, which who actually invested in us in a Series B and is now helping us build a team on the ground there in Japan. So we're pretty excited about you know, taking our first serious step into Asia. Do the results stack up? Well, I think you can see from this graph that they definitely do. So this is a graph of our first internationalization in Germany. And the graph is growth benchmarked against our US market, our most mature market. And you can see from the midpoint here, when we actually put the site into German, growth really started to take off. Now, one caveat about internationalization is that you definitely don't want to do it too early. You know, going back to the very first point of, you know, focusing on a key market, internationalization definitely adds layers and layers of complexity. And, you know, makes life definitely a little bit more difficult for the entire development team. So you want to wait until you've got product market fit and, you know, you're fairly mature before you go and actually put the site into multiple languages. But if you do and when you do, it's definitely a good driver of sustainable growth. Seventh tip I have is always keep innovating. Now, you know, over the years of running design contests and getting to know our design community, we had established that actually a design contest is kind of like speed dating. Because, you know, if you think about it, you know, you jump into a room, there's 12 designers, they're all throwing logos at you, you find one that you like, you've met your match, and what you've actually formed is a pretty close connection with one particular designer. But the question is, you know, what happens after a design contest? And so customers would ring up and say, hey, you know, I've found a great logo, I've found a great designer, now I need a brochure designed. You know, what should I do? Do I have to go speed dating again, or can I use the same designer? And, you know, we would always say, no, you know, it's fine to use the same designer. That's part of the value we offer both parties. So we didn't try and keep everything locked into the platform. But of course, the only thing was we didn't have the tools to actually support that interaction on our platform. We did design contests, and this was a different way of working with, you know, a single designer. And so the customer and the designer, if they wanted to continue on that relationship, they would have to use email and PayPal and Skype, the old way of doing things. And that was fine, you know, like they got along with that. But then when we got to a certain point in size, when we were about, where our development team was about 15 people, we decided, okay, you know, there is another opportunity here, you know, for this follow-on work. We'd heard all of these stories of customers and designers meeting each other. These guys, does anyone know Startup Grind? I think there's a Startup Grind chapter in KL. So the founders of Startup Grind actually met on 99 Designs, which is pretty cool. So as well as, you know, having a follow-on design relationship, they actually decided to co-found a company, which is now become global. And so, you know, what we wanted to do is dip our toes into this follow-on opportunity. And again, you know, again, going with the MVP approach, we wanted to build the single simplest possible thing we could to try and validate how big that opportunity was. So rather than building the entire platform, all we did to begin with was build a tool called one-to-one invoices, where a designer could invoice a customer for some money, and that all the customer could do was pay that invoice. We didn't worry about anything else. And so when we released that feature to the marketplace, it actually took off, which was really cool. You know, we looked at the metrics and they were growing, and they were actually showing a lot of repeat usage. And so from that, we decided, okay, that's awesome. There's a real opportunity here. And we put a bigger development team behind it. And we ended up growing that into a platform called One-to-One Projects, which is specifically built for that follow-on relationship. And so this is a look at one of our prominent designers' profiles, a guy by the name of Ludabees. You can see he's won 124 contests, but he's also had 149 one-to-one projects, which shows that we're able to continue on a lot of these relationships between customers and designers, and you know, with 46 of his clients actually being repeat clients. Eighth tip is to build on your strengths. And you know, for us, you can do all of the innovating in the world and you know, kind of build new products, but a really important thing is to never lose sight of what makes you a great company. And so for us, that's not all of our tools and not all of our process. It's our design community. And so, you know, we have a really big community team. This could be a talk on its own, actually. But, you know, I'll just very quickly talk through, you know, the things that they do. You know, we educate our designer community. We put up, you know, lots of inspirational articles on our blog of, you know, things that are going on in the design world. We do lots of tutorials and actually invite our designers to do guest posts on our blog, and then you know, provide design roundups of interesting things on the internet that they should be aware of. We also, you know, engage pretty heavily with our design community. Obviously, we talked about the community contests, but we also have, you know, an active forum, an active Facebook page, a very active following on Twitter, and then designers actually on their own started organizing meetups all over the world. So in Indonesia and Jogjakarta and, you know, in Serbia, Eastern Europe, they started organizing meetups themselves on meetup.com where, you know, tens if not hundreds of designers would come together just to talk about their craft. And so, you know, we loved this, of course, and we wanted to kind of get behind it as well. So we started sending staff out and doing tours of Europe and also in Indonesia. And this was an initiative that we did in Indonesia whereby we actually sponsored cafes and called them the 99 Designs Cafe for a week at a time and basically created a co-working space for designers to come and work together. And then finally, you know, we promote our designers' work as much as possible. This is a section of the site called Discover where we actually allow designers to vote up each other's work. And, you know, that is a great way for us to, you know, foster a real community where designers, you know, can interact with each other. And, you know, most of the design that I've used in this presentation is actually design that's come from designers. The ninth and final point is know your why. And, you know, for us, our community was built by designers, for designers. And so we try as hard as possible to stay true to our philosophy of creating opportunity for designers, with the idea that if we do that successfully, then we as a company will also succeed. So our mission statement at 99 Designs is to help people create and grow. And that applies to both sides of our marketplace. So for, you know, designers, obviously, they're not just creating logos. You know, they're building up a customer base. They're growing, you know, their own online business, as well as, you know, providing a livelihood for their families. For customers, you know, they're not just launching a logo. They're launching their startup, you know, their dream. You know, we're providing access to design in ways that, you know, weren't possible before. You know, it's not just now that companies are restricted to having to pay tens of thousands of dollars for a design. And so the points I want to leave you with, you know, I guess one final takeaway is that, you know, when you think about what's changed between, you know, the 1800s and, you know, the landscape that my grandfather operated in and, you know, where we are today, you know, a lot of technology's changed, but then a lot of things also haven't. And I think, for me, a startup success really comes down to these three traits. If, you know, you know your why, if you have the curiosity to innovate and get out there and try something new, and, you know, if you're able to hustle and push past all the barriers and do whatever it takes to succeed, then I think there's never been a better time to go and take on the world. Thank you.